Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byf here. So today I wanted to talk about Cayde again. Well, sort of. We've had a lot of stories for Titans and Warlocks recently, and that trend for Warlocks at least continues today as well. I want to talk about a story from the new exotic weapon, Tommy's Matchbook, a story that also pertains to Arnor, Hunters in the City, and the state of things after Cayde's death. As a small note, I love lore like this because it gives us an insight into the way that things are in the ranks of the Guardians and the city at large. I think back a lot to things like great TV shows and what really made them fantastic for me. Things like, say, Battlestar Galactica, for me, were really great, not just because of a fantastic series of storylines and also some fantastic space battles, but also because of all the background information that made it feel like you were engrossed in the world. You know, it was things such as how the fleet is coping with a food and water situation day by day, and all these different things that people in the fleet just had to live with. Those little stories are of interest to me as well, and the story from Tommy's Matchbook is very much in that same vein. It's about the happenings and the day-to-day life of people in the city, more specifically, Hunters. The story involves a character called Arnor, who we first saw back in the season of The Drifter, and she also played a major role in the Drifter versus Vanguard loyalty quest. If you guys remember that, then you will remember that if you were a fellow snitch like myself, then you would actually get a lore book with a whole bunch of different communiques from her and a whole bunch of different events that went down tied to her. This is a really fantastic lore book if you have it, by the way, so go ahead and give it a read. But for the moment, we're going to skim over Arnor's previous story, save for a few details. Arnor is a member of the Praxic Order and the Hidden, both of which are very closely tied to the Vanguard. It should be no surprise then that Arnor herself is very hard tied to the Vanguard in terms of her loyalty, and she's pretty blunt when it comes to dealing with others in terms of her own investigative and just general authority. If somebody is standing in her way, she generally doesn't tend to take any BS. This story is all about her going to investigate a hunter's den in the city, and it's really also about what this tells us about the city at large. The other major point to touch on here is basically to do with the Vanguard Dare. When Cayde died back at the start of Forsaken, we saw this big series of problems begin to emerge in the city's leadership. The first one of these was to do with the lack of leadership for hunters and the fact that there was a void left by Cayde's absence and it needed to be filled. Normally, the slot of Vanguard Hunter Mentor was going to be filled thanks to the Vanguard Dare of the hunter in question. In short, a Vanguard Dare is something that allows a hunter's Vanguard to be placed in their job title. And beyond all of that, the Vanguard Dare has various different conditions each time that a Vanguard Hunter signs up. The particular conditions for Cayde's Vanguard Dare is that the one who killed him would have to take over as Hunter Vanguard, which leads us to a very interesting point because, well, frankly, with the way that Aldrin is being treated right now, he's not quite ready to take up those reins yet, and frankly, I don't think he even knows about it. So, that's a problem. The bigger point that needs to be sort of drawn here is the fact that everything is sort of tearing apart at the seams, and you can see this just from the strain on Ikora and Zavala. It's pretty evident given that their leadership positions are being seen as less legitimate ever since we had the stolen intelligence lore book from all the way back in the season of the Drifter. And of course, beyond all of that, they can't exactly just grab a hunter out of nowhere and pull them into their new assignment as Vanguard Mentor, because it would look as though they were coercing someone into that situation so that they could secure power. There's a lot of perception here going on, and whilst it's not talked about in the game, you can very easily tell just from the tension in this particular card. Of course, there was some restored confidence in the Vanguard, I think, thanks to the just sheer magnitude of the upcoming crisis on Luna. Simply knowing that we are facing the pyramid ships and the darkness and whatever may come from them soon is definitely enough reason to unify around what leadership is left, but the lore entry of Tommy's Matchbook tells us that the cracks are still very much there, and that hunters in particular aren't quite pulling their weight as far as the city's vanguard operations are concerned, and instead are trying to avoid certain parts of those operations so they cannot become the next Hunter Vanguard. Anyway, with all that said and with all that context added, this is the lore tab for Tommy's Matchbook. The entrance to the Hunter's Den on 7th Street immediately led to a flight of dark, dirty steps that went down two stories and multiple flights. A maglev train roared overhead as Arnor reached the bottom. She had blinked through the void to skip as many as she could. It made her a little angry. The hunters who built this place must have thought the stairs were theatrical and intimidating instead of a complete waste of time. Like this trip was turning out to be. The place was deserted. No one had passed her on the way down. Multiple card tables sat under a single rusty overhead lamp. There were a few possibly loaded sidearms left on the floor and rifles leaning against the walls. The occasional food wrapper from the deli upstairs accompanied the guns on the floor. There were more guns by far. Something moved in the corner. Arnor's Minuet 42 hand cannon came up in her fist. "Hey, whoa, no one draws in the den, are you crazy?" A hunter in full strike gear and his ghost walked out of the shadows, hands and shell pieces in the air. It was the ghost who had spoken. "Oh, a warlock, that tracks." The hunter looked on in silence. Arnor flashed her cormorant seal. "Arnor, Praxic Order." What does internal affairs want with a hunter den? The question itself was a lie. "Your names?" "I'm Tommy," said the ghost. "I'm Ghost," said the hunter. Arnor holstered the minuet, made another visual sweep of the room. Where is everyone? Hunters have been hard to find in the tower. Bounties and strike assignments are piling up. Tommy cocked his shell. "Drifter must have the Praxics working overtime." "Since Cayde died," Ghost drew a long knife across the back of his armored fist. It sang coldly. "Every single hunter worth their salt is either out on a mission to save the world, or spending their time away from the city, to avoid the Vanguard Dare." Arnor looked from Ghost to Tommy and back again. "Listen," Tommy whispered, as Ghost sheathed his knife and stepped forward. He held out a long, white-bodied rifle, with a flat, disc-shaped drum instead of a standard magazine. "This is the most expensive thing we own. You can have it. Just please don't tell anyone we were here. And get someone in that Vanguard chair. The hunters are losing their minds out there."
So, what did we just learn?
Well, we learned that the hunters are cowards. Okay, I kid. We learned that the hunters, as should be expected from them, are avoiding a position of authority that hinders their freedom. Hunters, above all else, value the ability to roam freely within the system, either in packs or alone. All things considered, it shouldn't be surprising that they're abandoning their dens within the city, lest the Vanguard should look to fill their position of Hunter Vanguard by force. The Vanguard really isn't in an easy position with this one either, because if they force a hunter to join again, it will look like an attempt to coercively secure power. Beyond all of just this, we can see the real rift that Cayde's death has left, and that has torn itself into the city. Hunters are needed out on the front lines more and more, and Vanguard operations are being avoided like the plague. Instead, personal quests are being undertaken, hunters are trying to save the world, or have abandoned the city entirely. Hunters are keen to see the Vanguard position filled, if only so that the status quo can be restored. If anything else, it just shows some more of what I was touching on earlier, the background details. An empty hunter's den is telling in Destiny's world. This place should be hustling and bustling. But instead, the guns have been left on the ground. Hunters have abandoned their responsibilities. The city, on the face of it all, looks relatively unchanged, but some of its structures are internally tearing themselves apart. The city, at current, is in a place where change is more than possible. It may be that that change is represented by Aldrin stepping into the boots of Vanguard Hunter one day, but if Bungie decides to play on the theme, the fraying of its internal structure could take many different forms, and there's many interesting conflicts that could be a central source of storytelling if these internal structures are played on in the future. I don't think this likely at all, but there are interesting possibilities that you could imagine.
Take an imaginative gander at something like, say, the faction known as the Concordat, previously led by Lysander, or the hunter group known as the Trinary Star Cult. Imagine if one of these groups, which has been known to be very much anti-authority and also anti-vanguard and anti-consensus, were to make a resurgence within the city. It could change the face of humanity as we know it, it could change city politics drastically, and beyond all of just this, their return could mark a huge point in the story because it could lead to a civil war of some kind. The world is full of possibilities here, and Tommy's matchbook lays clear the reasons for that. As a result, I think this is one of those interesting lore tabs that's interesting in the broader context of Destiny itself. But on its own, you might miss just because there's a lot of stuff here that requires a little bit of finesse to unpack. All of that being said though, that brings us kind of to the end of our video today. My apologies for the shorter one. I understand that you guys are probably looking forward to something which is a little bit more substantive and meaty. And don't worry, as the IO bunker comes online, if there's any new lore surrounding that stuff and just things to do with Rasputin generally, we'll get onto that. I also want to go ahead and in future videos continue to discuss Fellwinter. There's still one more video that I need to research and do as far as I know, and there may be other things going forward. It's a lot to do with Fellwinter's connection to Rasputin. Just to give you a little preview, if you've seen the exotic ship from Eververse that is related to Fellwinter in this season, it's very much related in that same vein as what that ship's lore tab goes through. But regardless of all of that, I hope that you guys enjoyed the video, and if you did, go ahead and leave a like. On top of that, if you had your own thoughts, leave them down below in the comments section. If you want more Destiny lore and more Destiny content generally, go ahead and hit the subscribe button and the bell next to subscribe. But of course, know that your viewership, as always, is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been, my name is Bife, Purodasia Arastra. I'll see you, Starside.